as well. So again, a good morning to each one. Those of you who made it to Greenfield District, you were undeterred by the news of the impending storm. Welcome this morning to Greenfield. Those of you who are at home and watching us online, wherever you may be, we're glad that you've tuned in with us as well. And we trust that you are all keeping well wherever you are. I was kind of contemplating whether to change my message today because, you know, whenever a situation like this occurs, sometimes you think, should I shift my message? And you think about it, you pray through it. But I really felt, no, the Lord's saying, no, stick with what you have prepared in this series because storms will come, storms will go. It won't disappear. But what I desire for you to do is to continue to trust and believe in me. And I believe that we've done that today. Pastor Pat has also exhorted us and encouraged us to continue to stay centered in the Lord. So I'm going to obey the leading of the Lord just to stick with our series, in our sermon series today. And so if you missed it last week, we did start a new series called Open Hands and Full Hearts. Open Hands and Full Hearts. It's the money series. So every now and then we do want to talk about this at ICS Church because in the scriptures, God talks about it. He inspired writers to write about finances and stewardship. And so in scriptures, we actually find a lot of references, a lot of teachings, a lot of principles taught about money matters. In fact, money is mentioned more times than faith. So this is something that was true in the Old Testament. It's something true when Jesus was here on earth. In fact, he addressed it and he told the listeners in one of his sermons, do not serve God and money. You can only have one. You cannot be led by one or the other. You can only choose to have one lord over your life. So it's something that's important. And so at ICS Church, we want to take time to also learn about it and to teach about it as well. So today is part two in this series. What brings you joy? What brings you joy? When are you most happy? I know December is one of the happiest times in the Filipino calendar. In fact, globally, we are starting to be known as the nation with the longest Christmas season in the world, which still surprises a lot of people because Christmas decorations go up beginning September. And aside from us being already a happy people, if you can make Filipinos even happier, begin the Christmas season. Right? It seems that that's what happens. If Filipinos are happy, Christmas makes them extra happier, especially if you get gifts, right? Does that bring you joy? If your love language is gifts, that definitely will brighten your day. Christmas, not just birthdays, brightens your day. You know, psychologists talk about the five love languages. For me, when I was younger, it was gifts. Gifts was my love language as a little kid. So whenever I would get a gift, you know, that made my day. I felt so loved and appreciated and thought about when I would get a gift. But I noticed over time that has changed. So I think when you get older, you know, your love language change. And my love language presently is actually quality time and words of affirmation. So yeah, you know, if you tell me you look good today, Pastor Chad. Yeah, that really, I feel loved when you tell me that, right? If you say, you know what, I appreciate your message today. I feel loved. I really feel appreciated. So it changes over time. I'm not saying that you should do that to me under no obligation. I'm also not saying that you should not give me gifts. If you want to give me a gift, I will receive it. I will appreciate it still. But those five love languages, and if you know what yours is, it's interesting to see, because when your love language is spoken to you, it brings you joy. It brings you joy. It's something that is done externally, but something from within wells up and causes you to be happy, appreciated. And the question today that I want to ask is, do you have joy when you give? Amen. Amen. So Tita Jeff is giving a loud amen over on that side. I guess the rest of us were kind of like, I don't know. Something I have to think about. It wasn't a quick amen. It wasn't like we're all jumping for joy. You know, when you say, hey, would you want to give to this? You always pause. Usually when somebody comes up to you and say, would you like to buy? That requires giving. You have a lot of questions, right? You pause and bring up questions before you make a decision whether you are going to give your money away to this that they're asking you to or not. So giving doesn't really inspire joy in a lot of people, not always. It's not the first attitude that comes to mind when you're encouraged to give, but it is important. In fact, in scriptures, in a passage we're going to read today, we're reminded by Paul that we're supposed to be cheerful. Cheerful when we're giving. See, and when we hear that, it's like, yeah, how do I get there? You know, I know I'm supposed to give, I want to give, but to be cheerful in giving, to add cheer, add joy when you give, I don't know. It's not always automatic. Definitely for unbelievers, it's not automatic, but even for believers, even for those who follow Jesus, even for Christians, it's not always something you look forward to that brings joy, that brings cheer. Truett Cathy is a guy, he's a businessman. So if you're in business, it's a name that you may be familiar with. Truett Cathy is the founder of a food business called Chick-fil-A. You already have the quote there. I'll read it in a moment. But Truett Cathy is the founder of Chick-fil-A. It's one of the most successful food businesses in the United States. It's not a global business. It's a private entity called Chick-fil-A. And Truett Cathy is a devout Christian. And as a devout Christian, he believes that on Sundays, you're supposed to honor the Lord. So he encourages his employees to go to church. He doesn't conduct business on Sundays. Chick-fil-A is closed on Sundays in America. So you go to a Chick-fil-A fast food restaurant, drive through on a Sunday, it's closed. It's closed. Because as a committed Christian, he believes, nope, Sunday is for the Lord. I want to encourage everybody to go to church. He's going to go to church. So God has blessed him with business aptitude, but at the same time, God has blessed him, I believe, primarily because he has honored the Lord. And one of the things that he said, and I quote Truett Cathy, he says, nearly every moment of every day, we have the opportunity to give something to someone else, our time, our love, our resources. I have always found more joy, there you go, in giving when I did not expect anything in return. So this has always been his value, whether he was starting off in business or now he's kind of turned it over to his son. That's always been the values that has driven him personally. It's driven his business, right? They're one of the most generous businesses. In fact, one of the most successful, even more profitable than KFC. That's also in the chicken business in America. And even though they're not a global company, they're actually one of the top companies in the food industry in the United States. So he found something, he discovered something as a follower of Jesus that he doesn't just do personally, it actually affects even his business, the industry that he lives in. And I believe it's because of these things plus good business practices that God has honored Truett Cathy and has blessed the business of Chick-fil-A. Here's a couple of big ideas I want us to understand and learn this morning. As God's children, how we give is more important than what we give. How we give is more important than what we give. And you say, come on, I mean, what we give, the money that I give, the amount, isn't that important? That's important. But more important when it comes to our relationship with God and as a Christian is how. So the how, if I could rephrase the statement, would be, as God's children, our attitude, everybody say attitude. Our attitude when we give is more important than what we give. So the how is all about our motivation, our behavior, our attitude. When it comes to our relationship with God and our relationship with money, with God in the middle of these things. Puso, if I could use Tagalog now, puso is more important than pera. PP. I was trying to think of something in English, couldn't think of anything. It worked this morning at the 8 a.m. So that's kind of, our heart is more important than the money that we give. And really, this is something that was true in the Old Testament. It's something true in the New Testament, the Old Covenant, the New Covenant. It's something that God talked about and taught, both in the Old and in the time of Christ, and even in the book of Acts. When Jesus ascended, it was the lifestyle of the church. So this is important for us because money is something that we use every day. Our behavior when it comes to giving is also important, apparently, when it comes to our attitude. Because this reflects our belief in God, our faith in God, and how it translates to how we address finances, material possessions, time, and yes, even our talents. In the same passage that we started reading last week, we're going to go back to that as well. Paul, writing to the Corinthian church, he said in 2 Corinthians 9:7, each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves, here it is, a cheerful giver. God loves us, doesn't just love a giver, he says he loves a cheerful giver. It's a cheerful giver. It's not about what you give, it's about how you give. Cheerfulness in giving. So that's important. Cheerfulness in giving is important. I understand that many of us may be generous. We talked about that last Sunday. Generosity is a mark of a God follower. In fact, we reflect God when we are generous. But it's not just about giving, it's how we give. That's also important when it comes to our relationship with God and our relationship with money. Cheerfulness is a disposition. This is an intrinsic quality that manifests outside. In the process of giving, there is cheer, there is joy, there is fulfillment. There's a part in us that feels satisfied when we actually give. Is that true for you today? That's the question. Is that true when we give? Now, when Paul wrote this, he was talking to the Christians in the city of Corinth. So, little geography and historical background. Corinth is actually a main city. This is a main city in the province of Achaia. And why was he addressing the Corinthians here? Because he was encouraging them and preparing them. He said, before he mentioned this, he said, you know what? I have been telling the church in Jerusalem, the church in Macedonia, about how generous you are and that you are actually ready to give towards their need. It's not to the Corinthian church. Now, I just want to be sure that when I come, that you are actually ready to give. Isn't that thoughtful of Paul? He was so thoughtful that he would write a letter ahead of time before he visited them so that they could be ready. Because he said, I don't want it that if I have other people from Jerusalem or Macedonia who would accompany me on this trip, and I've been telling them you're generous when I arrive, that you are actually not ready to give to their need. That's going to be embarrassing for you. So I want to be sure in this letter, he's saying, that you are actually, in fact, ready. And here are some of the tips to be sure, some of the attitudes, some of the motivations, some of the priorities that you need to have when it comes to giving. That's the context of what he was saying here. And he was saying, I need for you guys to check your motive. I need for you to check your attitude so that when I come, you're not going to be embarrassed. You're actually prepared. Let me know ahead of time. Are you ready or not? So if you're ready, then that's going to be joyful. So in this passage, we have observed three things. Number one, we are responsible for what and how we give. You're responsible. You decide, Paul said. You decide. It's not my decision to make. It is not the Jerusalem church's decision to make for you. You decide what you ought to give, what you're supposed to give. That's the beauty about following God. God doesn't obligate us, right? Second observation, our posture in giving to God or others should never be done with reluctance or obligation. Is that with reluctance or obligation? First of all, you're responsible for your giving. Why? Because it's been given to you. It's your money. It's your possessions. So the decision for that possession lies in your hands. But don't feel as well that, you know what, when you give, this is the attitude, that you're reluctant, you're half-hearted, that you feel obligated. That's how we feel sometimes, right? You know, sometimes when we get money and it's not ours, we're careful with it. Are you careful with money that's not yours? For those of you who are treasurers in your organizations, in your business, or in your family, you're the one entrusted with the care of finances, right? It's not just yours, it's the combined income. You want to be careful with that because it's not yours. But if it's yours, you have free will to do. What do you want? I make the decision because it is mine. How many of us feel obligated when it comes to giving? Right? At the end of the month or every 15th and 30th, there's an obligation. If you're employed in the Philippines, the government requires businesses to pay taxes. And if you are an employee and you're above, right, the minimum wage, you are also required to pay your taxes. And a portion of that goes into housing and Social Security. So even though the gross income may be big, oh man, that's what I'm gonna get, by the end of the taxes, it's like, that's what I'm gonna get, right? The excitement kind of disappears because there is now an obligation. The company's obligated and you are obligated. So there was a time when some people have the option of doing that personally, but now the companies, they just auto-deduct it. So what you get at the end of the day, what goes into your bank account, pretty much is your net pay. That's pretty much what you get. And so some of us, when we have to pay those taxes at the end of the year, for business owners, we have to give an account to the Bureau of Revenue, right? And we have to say, ito yun, this is what I spent, this is what I owe the government for conducting my business. It doesn't necessarily bring us joy, right? Because you feel like, I could use that money to expand my business, to do other things, but now I'm obligated. Obligated. It's an obligation to pay the government. You don't feel joy when you do that. I mean, for some people, they may be joyous, don't get me wrong, but for others, I really don't want to do this, but I have to. Why? Because if you break that obligation, what happens? The government can actually file a criminal case against you. You break the law. You're not paying what you're supposed to pay. You have this business, you're bringing in millions or a few thousand. You owe us. We gave you a warning. We've gave you new reminders. You haven't paid. Your obligation, your duty. And so because of this, you've broken the law, and we will now file a criminal case against you. The government can do that against business owners who do not pay what they're supposed to pay in government. That's obligation. And Paul says to the Corinthian church, I don't want you guys to give towards others and even towards Jerusalem, towards God, out of obligation. It's sad because sometimes we feel this way, right? You know, when it comes to, somebody comes up and says, hey, it's time to give the offering. It's like, yeah, not my favorite part in the church service, right? That attitude comes up. And the question is, why? Why? You're not being obligated to give. Paul says it's not an obligation. Giving should not be, whether it is in the church or outside of the church. Whether it's to God or others, giving should never be. You shouldn't be reluctant. He says, third observation, the right attitude in giving should be cheerfulness. Cheerfulness. Joy. It should bring excitement, right? I get to give. So how do we get there? Because maybe for many of us, yeah, I'm not excited about giving. Whether it's giving in the church, giving to my family, giving to my business, giving to my government. When you ask me to give, it doesn't excite me, Pastor Chad. But Paul says, Corinthian believers, followers of Christ, when it comes to giving, whether it is to another church, to the Jerusalem church, to the Macedonian church, to others who are in need, here's kind of the expectation. You have free will. But it should be done not with reluctance. It should be done not with obligation or compulsion. It should be done cheerfully. Here's a thought. To develop the right way to give, we must mind our motives and pay attention to our attitudes. I believe as we begin to check our motives, observe our attitudes, it will help us shift from a worldly mindset that's all about mine and losing to God's and gaining. Wait, hold on. How can we gain if we're giving away? How do we develop the right attitude? It begins with motives. It begins with motives. We talked last week about the value of generosity and how generosity is actually something that God does. That's who He is. And when we do this, it actually reflects Him. We need to mind our motives. The right motive when giving should reflect the goodness of God and generosity of our Heavenly Father. Our motive, our inspiration should be God. Should be God. How can our motive be God? In the same passage, remember last week, Paul said, God is the one who will supply the seed to the sower. And Paul was basically saying, you are the sower. Corinthian church, ICS church, you're the sower. God is expecting you to sow generously. And when you sow generously, it's actually going to come back to you. Not always materially, but sometimes even better. Spiritually, you will be enriched in every way so that you can abound in every good work. Talked about that last week. It is the goodness of God. It is God Himself. Yes, I work the work of my hands. I produce this on the 15th, on the 30th, or the efforts that I pour in. I'm able to build something that is profitable. It profits me, but then we learn we're expected to live generously. Guess where the ability to produce wealth came from? Scripture says that comes from God. The ability to produce wealth comes from God. He is the one who provided the seed so that the sower can actually sow and eventually reap the harvest. So the skills, the ability, the opportunities, life itself, if you want to go there, it's from the sower. What I have, the job that I have, the business that I have, the possessions that I have, is from the Lord. Yeah, I mean, you know, my dad's rich. Yeah, who made your dad rich? God did. Right? I mean, we could try to explain these things out, but ultimately, at the end of the day, God is the one who provides. You may recognize Him, or you may not recognize Him. But in the Christian worldview, that is what we believe. That's what we find in Scriptures, that none of us, right, are self-made. There are opportunities that open up to us. We step into it, but the one who gives us the skill, the one who provides good health, the one who allows us to continue to live prosperously is the sovereign will of God. So in the Christian worldview, hey, when we give, it has to be the motivation that we have that God is the source of all things. His goodness is what motivates me. His goodness to me, His goodness towards others. His generosity to me, His generosity to others. We give because He first gave. And He gave His best. Jesus was His ultimate offering, and Jesus gave His best. Jesus did not hold back. But a lot of times, we have the wrong motives. We don't understand this. Why? Because sometimes, even as Christians, we are infected and still affected by the worldly ways around us. What are the wrong motivations when it comes to giving that affect our disposition to actually have joy, to have cheer? When we give to get attention, that's a wrong motivation. Do you give to get attention? I'm going to give so I will get attention. I'm going to give so everybody will say, hey, look at him, right? Now, a lot of people do that every now and then. In a few months' time, we're all going to go to the polls to elect. Guess who's going to be elected? The one who is remembered the most, right? And unfortunately, for many, they use money. They use money. So that, hey, I could get attention. You could remember my name. You could remember me. So that's a wrong motive. We don't give to bring attention to ourselves. We give because God is good. We give because God is generous. As believers, as Christians, that needs to be our motivation. Here's another wrong motivation when we give. I'm going to give to manipulate and control. Now, that's a sad thing, because the world that we live in, obviously, if you are employed, come on, here's legal, right? This is kind of the right way. If you are employed in a job, you are obligated to perform the duties and responsibilities that you have to fulfill the job description for which you were hired for. But sometimes, unfortunately, in some situations, money is used beyond that to manipulate and control. When they begin to ask you to do things outside of what you are legally obligated to do, then that is manipulation and control. Or when people begin to tell you, right? Don't you remember what I did for you then? Oh, right? So that's obligation. Yeah, that's a sad reality. For Christians who give, there is a cultural practice that we have that is actually not Christian. You know what it is? It's called utang na loob, debt of gratitude. And if you're a Christian and you sow goodness, you give to somebody else because you expect them to do favors on your behalf later on, that is not Christian. Can I tell you right now? That is not God-honoring. That is actually a sin. Nope, I said it. That's right, it's a sin. It may be cultural, but it's not Christian. So don't use money, don't use possessions to manipulate and control others. Don't use money to bring attention to yourself. That does not honor God. It is a sin against God. If we give, our motive should be, God is a good God. I didn't do anything to deserve His goodness in my life. Why should I do that to others? Come on. Because God is a good God, I'm going to sow goodness to others as well. So when I give, I don't expect in return. Even though in the kingdom of God, like what Paul says, when you sow, right? The law of agriculture in the kingdom of God, those who sow generously will reap generously, but we don't sow for that purpose. That's just the law. That's just how it works. But we don't give to get. We give because God gave. We give because God is good. We give because God is generous. That's our motivation. It's God. It came from Him. I'm a caretaker. I'm a steward, and that is what I will do. That's the right motive. We need to pay attention to our attitudes when we give. The right attitude in giving reveals the joy of our Heavenly Father in providing for His children. How can you give cheerfully, right? When you give without joy, you feel like you're losing something. That's why we're not happy a lot of times when we give. We feel like it's a loss. It's a loss. Or sometimes we give, I'm going to give because there's a good ROI. So you're still expecting a return, a good return of your investment. But when we give, it's out of joy. We don't give a lot of times, not because we have an excess. No, we give because, again, we go back. Who provides the seed? The sower. the sower. God is the one who provided the seed to the sower. God is the one who provided the seed to the sower. It is God who gave me this. I am but a steward. I'm a caretaker. This is not mine. So a lot of times when we think, this is my hard work, I endeavor to do this, I have the right to decide what to do with it. No, you don't. Because the reality is, everything belongs to the Lord. In fact, somebody wanted to trap Jesus one time, and he came to him and he says, hey, Jesus, I've got this coin, I got this money, should we pay taxes? Because you said the kingdom of God is here, right? We should be paying to the kingdom of God, right? So should we still pay taxes to Caesar, who is Lord? What does Jesus say? He said, give to Caesar what is Caesar's, right? Look at your coin. Whose face is on that? It's Caesar's face. Give to Caesar what is Caesar's. You need to pay taxes, pay your taxes. Give to God's what is God's. What belongs to God? What belongs to God? Everything, even Caesar's life, he owes to God. So you give to Caesar what is Caesar's, yeah, that's his. Give to God what is God's. Everything belongs to God. It's like, whoa. He didn't break the law. He actually said, yeah, the kingdom of God is here. The king is here. Everything belongs to the king. The earth and all the fullness thereof and all who live in it, psalmist tells us. There's only joy when we recognize that what we possess, whether it is our time, our talent, or our treasure, is actually not ours. There's actually freedom in knowing this, right? There's freedom in knowing that the provider of the seed will never run out of seed. That the provider of all that we need will never run out. So I'm going to give my best. I'm going to do my best. And I'm going to use the seed. You're supposed to use it. You're not supposed to keep the seed. You're not supposed to hoard it. You're supposed to use it. Because when you use it, what's going to happen? Your needs will be met. And there's going to be extra so that you can meet the needs of others as well. When you sow little, you will harvest little. When you sow in abundance, you will harvest in abundance. But the seed never runs out. Because the provider of the seed is God. He's the one who meets every need. That brings me peace. Right? If you're employed by somebody that you know is secured. Usually that's what we look for. We look for somebody who is secured ED. Because we feel like, yeah, on the bank, they have enough assets. There's not going to be any problems for me. We feel like, yeah, these companies, top companies to find employment in, and we strive to get into those top 10 companies so that our needs would be met. You need to look for somebody who is secure. Mine is the D. God is secure. Because economy doesn't affect him. Weathers don't affect him. Wars does not affect him. His provision and his resources are immense. It will never run dry. There will always be seed for the sower. Knowing that should give us assurance. Knowing that should give us peace. And if you have peace in knowing that your provider is present and is always ready with ample supply to provide for your needs, there will be joy when you give. Because it is not mine. It belongs to the one who gave me the seed so I could give it to others. Yes, it meets my needs, but it meets other people's needs as well. The wrong attitude, Paul says, is when we do this reluctantly. We give reluctantly at times because we feel like we're going to lose something. We're half-hearted. I don't know if I should, because what about me? What about my needs? Who's the giver of the seed? God is. We're just a sower. We sow into our field, we can also sow in the fields of others so that they can also have something to sow especially those who do not yet know God. Isn't that amazing? We could actually provide seed for other people who don't yet have seed. Why? Because the provider of the seed is God. It is abundant. We give reluctantly, we give under compulsion. God doesn't require us, but He gives us an opportunity to join Him. You see, there are groups that require, it's not just the government. Sometimes religious groups require you to give. I'm grateful that at ICS Church, we don't. So if you say, you know, I want to be part of ICS Church, I want to be a member of this church, we don't ask you to fill out your details and then, can you give us your payslip every 15th and 30th of the month as well? Will that excite you? Will you say, I want to be part of ICS Church? Yeah, here's my payslip. Now, some of us don't even show our payslip to our spouses. Come on. Ouch, bato-bato sa langit. Right? Because it's like, this is mine. I'm not going to show it to anybody else. It's a secret. It's not an obligation. Jesus never obliged people. In the book of Acts, the apostles never obliged people. Report to us what you get. No. It says there that the disciples gave willingly and they laid it at the apostles' feet. It was willingly. It wasn't obligatory. That's why when we have an offering time at ICS Church, it's free will giving. Free will. This is not an obligation. You don't have to feel guilty when the bag passes you by and you don't put anything in it because it is between you and the Lord. In fact, for the majority of us, you don't even use the bags anymore. You just transfer online, right? You give your tithes, you give your offerings online. You don't even let the bag pass you by, the boxes. That doesn't mean anything to you. Why? Because it's between you and the Lord. It's not for show. It's not anyone else's business. And when we understand this, that it's free will, not out of compulsion, not out of obligation, then there is no pressure. There's no pressure. Don't feel pressured when it's offering time. Don't feel pressure when the bag passes you by. No, check your motives. Check your attitudes. Because the right attitude is giving freely, willingly, and cheerfully. That's why there is joy. Because we know that God is the provider, and we know now that we have an opportunity to participate in the way that He expresses generosity in the world. He has chosen to use the church. He has chosen to use you and me, His sons and daughters in the kingdom of God, to be an expression of His provision, of His generosity, of His love in the world today. This is contrary to the worldly systems. Because the worldly system says, right? Matira matibay. Right? Last man standing, every man for himself. The strongest survive. That's the worldly system. But in the kingdom of God, it says, no, we want to help. We want to sow love, generosity. We want to help and extend where it's needed. We get there because of Jesus. So to summarize this, we could say, to have the right motive and attitude for giving, give as Jesus gave. How did He give? Lovingly, selflessly, freely, generously, cheerfully. You say, but I'm not Jesus. Are you a child of God? And live as a child of God. That's what children of God do. They follow the way of their master, and that is Christ. It is the love of God that motivated Christ to do what He did. When He came to earth, He did so because He loved the Father. He loved those that they created together, all of humanity in the world. He came because of His love. And whenever His love was required, His presence, His attention, His ability was required, He did not turn away from anyone. He gave Himself willingly. Whether it was, you know, He was busy going to a place, ready to meet people and do things, but when somebody touched Him in faith, He stops. He says, "Who touched me?" I felt power go out of me. And this person that everybody was ignoring, everybody was telling to be quiet, says, "That was me. I'm sick." And Jesus says, "Go, your faith has made you well." Jesus had time to stop in his tracks, to be distracted, even when he was tired. Do you remember that time he'd been preaching and ministering the entire day, and he decides, "I'm going to go sit down and rest, maybe under a tree." And I can just imagine the disciples, maybe Peter, right? His hands up. "All right, everybody stand back, stand back. Jesus is resting, stand back," right? It's like automatic security. Jesus never requested security. Jesus never asked them to hold people back. And so as you do, apparently, Jesus was so kind, was so non-threatening that children were drawn to him. So the parents came with their kids, and they were bringing them to Jesus. And of course, the kids were about to go to Jesus. And Peter says, no, you cannot come near. And Jesus, I can just imagine Jesus saying, "Peter, what are you doing? Peter, get away. Let the children come to me. The kingdom of God belongs to them as well. It's not just for you. You think you're special? You are, but so are they." And he blesses the children. He allows them to come. He was tired. He was weary. But he said, "Do you know what? This is the love of God. This is the reason why I came. I'm going to express the goodness of God. I'm going to express the love of God. I'm going to release the power of God wherever I go, even when I get interrupted." Sometimes it's hardest to give when we are interrupted. When you're in your car, you're just wanting to go home, you're stuck in traffic, somebody knocks on your window. It's an interruption. And all these things come into your mind. Sa sindikato yan, wag ka bumigay, you know, don't give anything. You know, it's a gang. And I'm thinking, man, what would Jesus do? Would he say that? Did he interview these people? "Are you part of this syndicate? You little children, why are you coming to me?" Right? Right? "Is there somebody there watching you?" No. He said, "Let him come." He says, "I'm going to heal you." He tells the Samaritan woman, "I could give you water so you will never be thirsty anymore." And everybody else was ignoring her, and she was ostracized. Jesus took time. He was generous with his time. He was generous with his love. He was generous with what he had. And he gave. This is what he expects us to do. This is what God expects us to do. Billy Graham, a popular evangelist preacher, he said, "God has given us two hands, one to receive and the other to give with. We are not a cistern made for hoarding. We are channels made for sharing." That's what we are. God has deposited his spirit in us. God has deposited his presence in us, his love in us, his goodness, and yes, even his provisions. Not for us to hoard, for us to give, to dispense. Because when we do, we honor God. God loves a cheerful giver. Why? Because a cheerful giver knows where his provision comes from. A cheerful giver knows that the provision that he has, whatever he has, is not his. It's from his master. A cheerful giver knows that he is only a conduit, a channel, and not a dam or a cistern to withhold the goodness and the blessing of God from others. What do we need to do today? Is it a mind shift that needs to take place? Is it a heart change that needs to happen? Or do we just need to start giving? You're not going to know the joy of giving until you actually start giving. And do so in honor of God. Do so knowing that God is the one who blessed you. Do so knowing that when you do, you become just like Jesus. This morning, Pastor Justice was sharing to us an experience that he had last night after his date with his fiance. Yes. He was on the jeepney on his way home. And as you do, it's late night. As he was on a jeepney, suddenly another passenger rode in the jeepney with him. And this passenger looked a bit sus. That is Gen Alpha's way of saying suspicious. So he looked a bit suspicious because he had a black hoodie, all black. His face was covered, wearing shorts, wearing flip-flops, and he looked a bit nervous. His hand was kind of shaking a little bit. And so Pastor Justice was ready, he was alert, he was vigilant, and he was saying, you know what? Whatever the evil intention of this person is, I'm ready. Whether he needs to run away to bolt or whatever, he was ready. And all of a sudden, this guy in a black hoodie said, is it okay if I pray for you guys here in the jeepney? And Pastor Justice was rebuked, because the moment this guy started praying, he felt like, man, he's a family. He's part of the spiritual kingdom of God. He begins to pray for God's protection over the storm, God's provision, and God's peace to every person in this fully packed jeepney until the end. Finally, when he said amen, Pastor Justice looked at him and gave him a thumbs up. Is that something that we would do? See, that's normal for a child of God. That's normal. Just don't take an offering at the end, all right? Because that destroys your testimony. It's like all the good things that you just said, all the prayers that you just mentioned, just, man, everybody forgot that because you passed an offering back. No, that's not what we talk about when it comes to giving. No, end it right there. It's the goodness of God. You know, sometimes when somebody knocks on the window, the God and the Holy Spirit may direct us and says, roll the window down. Give him something, but don't let him go just at one thing. If it's still traffic, the lights haven't changed, or the cars are not moving, would you offer to pray? Hey, can I just pray for you? Here's something for you, but before you go, can I just pray for you? Silver and gold I may not have, but what I have, I give it to you. Jesus. Let Jesus' peace remain. Let Jesus' protection come. Let Jesus' provision come. Yes, even healing. Because when we declare the good news, these things will follow those who believe. Jesus said this in the Gospel of Mark. Healing, signs, wonders, miracles. This is the normal. It's abnormal when somebody comes to us with a need and we ignore them. That's the way of the world. But not for the sons and the daughters of the kingdom of God. When somebody comes to you with a need, don't let your suspicions be the first thing that comes up. Let your faith in God be the one that is triggered. Lord, you led this person to me. How do you want me to respond? If you have the power to act where you are, Proverbs tells us, do so. Release a blessing, materially, spiritually. Release it, declare it. Because you don't know what they're going through, but God does. He brought them on your path because God wants you to move on His behalf, to sow generously, to sow love, to sow a miracle so that His kingdom would grow where He has led you. Come on, ICS Church, are you ready to give cheerfully to the Lord? Are you ready to give cheerfully where He leads you this week? It may be in unexpected situations, but would you respond with faith, not with fear, not with suspicion, not with worldly thinking, but be renewed in your mind as a son, as a child of the King. Declare faith, declare goodness, declare the love of God, declare His peace generously wherever you go. Come on, would you stand today with us? And as we end this morning, it's always important to respond with repentance. When we are confronted with the truth of the Word of God, the commands of Jesus that He asks us to do, to ignore the conviction of the Holy Spirit is sin, because we're rejecting God. So I want to encourage you today, however He's spoken to you, would you respond to Him with a repentant attitude? Attitude that says, Lord, I'm sorry because I was thinking wrong, I was living wrong, but I want to make it right and I want to start following you. Repentance is simply saying, Lord God, not my way, your way. Help me to shift and follow in your direction and to obey you. And from here, begin to live according to His instruction. Your obedience is the fruit in keeping with repentance. That's the fruit. When you actually obey what Jesus has asked you to do. But right now, just where we are, we're going to sing and worship to the Lord. We want to tell Him, thank You, Lord, for Your word. Thank You, Lord, for Your promises. Thank You, Lord, for Your instruction. We receive it in our good soil. We receive it in our heart, and we ask that You take root so that it will produce an everlasting fruit. We sang a song earlier called Keep Your Promises. Lord God, we want to declare this over our life and over our situations today. In Jesus' name.
You keep Your promises. Your goodness never ends.
Yes, Lord.
From generation to generation.
Keep the
covenant. You keep Your covenant. Come. It is written, it's not by power or might, but by the Spirit of the living God in us. You keep Your promises, Your goodness never ends. From
faith today, say,
we will trust You and believe, as it's written, let it be. You alone will be a firm foundation. What You've spoken is enough, it's the ground we're standing on. You are God and we will not be shaken. We will trust You and believe, as it's written, let it be. You alone will be a firm foundation. What You've spoken is enough, it's the ground we're standing on. You are God and we will not be shaken.
Help us, Lord God, to walk in obedience to what You have said. Help us, Father, to produce fruit that will last for eternity. Help us, Lord God, to reflect a life of generosity, a life that constantly gives, because You gave. You give Your best. You give Your time. You give Your abilities. You give Your own treasure, Lord God, and there was always excess. When You performed a miracle of feeding the 5,000, Lord God, there were excess. And so we know, Lord, that when You bless us to give to others, there will be surplus so that we can continue to meet the needs of those around us. Not just our needs, but many others as well. So, Lord, pour out in abundance, Lord, blessing over the church. Pour out in abundance Your blessing over our lives. And help us to walk in uprightness and righteousness and holiness Lord, to give with the right motives, to give with the right attitude, to reflect the goodness, the generosity, the love of our God to a world that needs to hear it, Lord God, today. This morning, we always want to give an opportunity for those who need prayer to come. Our pastors and our leaders will be standing here at the front, ready to pray for you this morning. We're going to end our time together today. I'm going to pray, and we're going to be dismissed. But we ask that you honor the time of those who may be needing prayer this morning.